Hi, this is Graham and I do hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to today's video in which I'll be giving you a walkthrough of the procedures necessary to do focus stacking with the FZ200 and the Raynox 150 lens. If you saw the previous video, that was just a quick overview of the equipment you might need to do macro photography. In this video, I'm going to take you through the step-by-step instruction of how to do it with this particular rig. Here you can see I've got my camera set up. It's on a sturdy tripod. I've got the newer focus rail, which I alluded to in the previous video. This one's only like £24 in the UK, and I think it's the equivalent price on Amazon.com as well, $24. It's a two-axis focus rail, so you can do front to back and can do side to side. You don't often use side to side, but it does help you get the shot frame correctly if you've got the camera mounted with high magnification. Further through this video, I'll show you how to strip this down and get more stability out of it rather than having the two components, as stability is one of the issues you do have when you're shooting macro photography. Any sort of movement on the camera will preclude you from doing proper focus stacking. You can see I've got a light set up here. I've just got the two 36 LED lights. You don't necessarily need LED lights. You can use ordinary tungsten lights. Or if you've got a bright enough sunshine, if you're doing this outside, you won't need the lights at all. You can actually use flash as well. I've got the Raynox 150 mounted on the 52 to 43mm step down ring on the camera, not the flexible adapter that they supply with, as I think the step down ring gives you the optical centration needed to get perfect shots. I've got a simple setup. Here's some flowers, and unfortunately a fly that was stranded in a spider's web, and I managed to fish him out and put him on the flower. He's of course dead. But here I'm going to use this static subject just to take you through the whole process. I'll show you some other subjects that I've shot using the macro system, not only for plants and insects, but household objects as well. And it gives you a further insight into just what we can see in the macro world. Let's take a closer look at this setup, and I'll walk you through the process of taking these shots needed to stack them in subsequent software programs. So here we have the rig for shooting the macro using the focus slider. I'll show you a technique where you can use the manual focus of the camera itself, as that technically gives you the better result, as if you're using a slider, you're changing the perspective every time you move the camera towards the subject, and that can create some problems with the stacking software. Unfortunately, the manual control of the lens on these bridge cameras doesn't make that very easy, but you can do it. We'll go through the focus stacking using the focus rail first, and then I'll show you the technique for using the manual focus on the camera, and you don't need the focus rail setup. So this is the focus rail from Neua. It has two axes, one which moves the camera to and from the subject, and another axis which moves it side to side. The one we are interested in here is the one which allows us to move the camera backwards and forwards. You can probably see on the base of the slider is a scale, and that gives you an indication of just how much you're moving the camera. And with the FZ200 and the Raynox 150, with an aperture of say f5.6, there's about an eighth of an inch or 3mm depth of field. So to give the focus stacking program something to work with, we need to move the camera about 2mm on each shot. So I'll take the first shot with the closest focus, and then we move the camera closer by 2mm and take the shot. Then we move it closer by another 2mm and take the shot, until we've got the whole of the subject covered in an increment of pictures. Use the camera in the manual focus mode. You don't want the camera trying to autofocus during this procedure. So switch to manual focus mode, set the focus scale to about 1.5 meters, and then focus the camera by moving the slide backwards and forwards, or physically positioning your tripod so you get the subject in focus. When you've done that, you'll use the manual 2-second timer on the camera to fire the shot. Let's have a look from the backside of the camera how this operates. I'll now take you through the setup of the FZ200 of how to produce these focus stacked images. I've switched the camera to manual focus on the side of the lens barrel, and now I'm going to use the manual focus, and you get control of that when you have the manual focus in yellow. Once the manual focus icon is selected, i.e. it's yellow, you have then control of the camera by using the back control dial. So if I just move the back control dial to the left or to the right, it will bring us into the manual focus mode. And I'm going to set the manual focus roughly to about 1.5 meters. So I'm using the back control dial just to position the yellow bar, which is indicating the focus point, to about 1.5 meters. It's important when you're going to use the camera for manual focus that we start with something like 1.5 meters to give us some playroom with the focus. Now the camera has effectively set the focus to 1.5 meters, you notice on the back of the screen that the image is out of focus. We're going to bring that into focus by physically moving the tripod nearer or further away, or we're going to use the focus rail to bring the image back into focus. And I need to move the camera closer to that point, which is the front of the fly in focus. If you wanted to check the accurate focus, again use the manual control dial, move it to the right, press the center button, which gives you the opportunity to set the target position, and bring that over the eye of the fly. Now when we press the menu set, we can go down to the focus rail and move the position of the camera as the image will be magnified like that. And I can now just move the camera backwards and forwards. Again, if I want to check that, I've got to press the menu set to get us into the focus target area. Press menu set again, and then just use the focus slide to physically set the focus. So now we're at our closest focus distance. We've got the eye nice and sharp and in focus, and now we're going to sequentially take pictures from the foreground to the background until we get the very last tip of that fly's wing in focus. In terms of exposure, I will always use ISO for all my photographic needs, unless there's an absolute necessary need to go to ISO 200 or 320. I use my standard photo style, and as usual I have my +1 sharpening, -1 noise reduction, as this gives me the best possible JPEGs out of the camera without too much post-processing. We're in aperture priority mode, and I've got this set to f6.3. Anywhere between f4 and f7.1 it is within the sweet spot range of the camera. If you're using f8, you'll run into diffraction limited resolution problems, so you should step away from f8. f7.1 is the top limit that you want to use with this camera. With f6.3, we've got a sufficient depth of field to give us opportunities to just stack a few photographs rather than many if we use the f2.8. So we have the camera set up now to take the first picture. I'm now going to enable the 2-second timer, because what we don't want to be doing is handling the camera whilst the exposure is taking place. Once we've got the 2-second timer enabled, release the shutter. The camera will settle down in terms of oscillations and take that first shot. Now I'm going to move the camera forward by 2 millimeters on the focus slide. And the focus point moves from the eye just to slightly behind the eye. And again, we'll take the next shot. And again, move the focus slide in by another 2 millimeters. We take the next shot. Move the slide by another 2 millimeters. You can probably see on the back screen that the focus point has shifted away from the eye now, and we're about halfway down the body of the fly. Move the slide another 2 millimeters. Move the slide another 2 millimeters. You can probably see now the focus point is shifting towards the very back of the fly. I'll just take one more to make sure we've got the last of the tip of the wing in focus. So those are the individual photographs which will be stacked in a program to enable us to merge those images together. There are several versions of software around which will do this for you. One is called Helicon, and that is the one I've been using at the moment. There is a 30-day try before you buy program there, so you can evaluate Helicon, or you can actually use Photoshop Elements. And if you're an Elements user, if you've got Elements 10 or 11, or if you've got the full-blown versions of Photoshop, there are some actions which will actually align the photographs for you and then merge them as a layered merge format. But we'll be using Helicon in this program, as it's a 30-day free trial. You can actually try this yourself, and if you like it, you can purchase the software. Let's take this setup now to the computer, and I'll walk you through the Helicon process to stack these images together. The program to stack the images we just captured in the camera is called Helicon Focus 6, and if I just start that interface, it brings us up with this opening menu. And obviously we need to bring in the seven images that I've captured on the camera to be able to stack them. To do that, we go to the file, open images, and I saved them into my Raynox tutorial folder, and they are images 100 to 106. So seven images we're going to bring into this program and stack them together. I'll show you the individual files. They're here on the right hand side of the screen, and that's the first image, which was the fly head. Then subsequently we stepped through the body of the fly until we got to the final wingtip to cover the whole focus range. To stack them together, we have one of three methods to choose: method A, which is weighted average, method B, which is depth map, and method C, which is pyramid. I've only really tried the weighted average and the depth map. Doesn't seem to be very much difference between the two. So I'm going to choose the default, which is method A, weighted average. Leave the defaults for the program as they are, and then just click render. The program will now step through those seven images and work out the focus for each individual shot, and then combine them with the previous one. So eventually we end up with a complete set of images all stacked into one image. So the program has finished rendering, and if I go into text and scale, you can see this is the finalized image. So we've got all from the tip of the head of the fly right to the very tip of the wing in focus. So the program has stacked it all together, and in this program now there doesn't look to be any artifacts. There's nothing out of place. Sometimes if you don't have enough depth of field for each individual shot, you'll find that you get bands of fuzziness through your image. So always increment your slider less than the actual depth of field that's been given by the lens. So if the depth of field is 3 millimeters, increment your slider by 2 millimeters, so there's always some overlap that this program can operate with. If you were wanting to retouch this program, so we wanted to take out these web filaments from the eye, we can go into the retouching menu, and we can increase the size of the image. And to move around within the image, press the space bar and then use the hand to drag it around. If you want to cover with texture, then these three icons on the right hand side are clone an area and then clone a texture. So I'm just going to clone texture. And I'm just going to select a brush size which is a little bit bigger. It's possibly too big. We'll just decrease that. And it's just like Photoshop, where you select a source with the right click of the mouse and then click to transfer that image. And just as in Photoshop, you keep changing your source point so you don't get a repetition of images. Quickly going over it, obviously you'd take your time to get this perfect, so you can't see any of the stitching of the program. You could of course take out these filaments from the rest of the body by doing the same technique. If I now go to text and scale, you can actually see that we've taken out that part of the filament from the eye, and it's as simple as that. You could actually do the same with all these spots on the image if you wanted to. Or when you save this, you can actually do it in your image editing program. If you wanted to add text onto the image, then you click the text button and you can see that I've got previous text in there. So I'm just going to drag that over to the right hand side and we'll downscale it. So we want to just drop this text size and then we can save the program. So go into the saving menu, click save, select the folder, select the file name and save it. Select the highest resolution and click OK. This is a procedure for using the manual focus of the camera rather than using focus slide. I've got a little plastic model set up here which is about 20 millimeters deep. That's just under 3/4 of an inch. So I'm going to try and focus from the front of the model right to the back. So you can see on the screen now that the nose of the model is in focus and the little ears at the back are out of focus. I've got manual control set on the camera, and if I just move the control dial to the right hand side, you can see that it's about just under 2 meters on the scale, although it's not actually 2 meters in reality because of the Raynaud's converter. But the nose is in focus, and remember, if we're in macro, if we're in the manual focus mode and we press the menu set button, we can actually enlarge the view in the center of the screen to see that we are in focus. So now that I've focused on the front of the nose, I'm going to take the first picture with the 2 second timer. Now again, I'll just rotate the top control dial one click to the right. That brings me into the menu, and then I'm going to go 2 clicks, which moves the focus slightly further forward. And I'm going to repeat the procedure again, turn 1 click to get into the menu, then 2 clicks on the dial, press the shutter button to get us back to the shooting screen, set our 2 second timer, and again 1 click to the right, 2 clicks in the menu, press the shutter button to come back to shooting mode, back to the 2 second timer. And we repeat that sequence until we've got all the way through to the back of the model. And then we have a complete set of pictures with the model from the foreground to the background covered in incremental steps using the focus of the camera rather than using the focus slide. Another useful technique is to use flash for your close-up macro photography. Here I've got a flash diffuser which I reviewed in a previous video. It's basically a piece of plastic and it holds a sort of golf ball shaped diffuser in front of the flash which gives you a nice broad soft light. So it's better than a point light source, you don't get the heavy black shadows. I've got the Raynaud's 150 on the FZ200 and no lens head because the lens head would cast a shadow onto the subject. Got the camera set for manual focus and I've set that to about 2 meters. The idea is that you're going to use a rocking technique to find the focus point rather than let the camera decide using automatic focus, because it will probably change as you make the exposure. The rocking technique is something you just have to learn. Basically, you're going to look through the viewfinder and then move the camera to and fro from the subject until you hit the focus point and then press the shutter. Using an aperture of f6.3, and the flash will determine the exposure, not the camera meter. So I'll take the first shot with minimum zoom, and it's a case of just rocking backwards and forwards until you find the subject in focus, and then take the picture. If it's too dark, sorry, if the picture is too light, then obviously decrease the flash power. Just going to increase the zoom range. I'm going to go to sort of half zoom times 12, and again finding that focus point by rocking the camera backwards and forwards. And then take the picture. When you go to full zoom, the depth of field is only about 2 millimeters, so the critical point is getting that focus right when you rock backwards and forwards. So the flash diffuser gives a nice soft light, the flash gives you the exposure so you don't get camera shake, and it's quite a convenient method if you want to shoot macro work outside. Even if the wind's blowing, if you can get that focus point, the flash will freeze the exposure. Here are some details about the newer macro slider, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. It doesn't come with a quick release part, so I've added those on. These are Manfrotto quick release plates, or copies of the Manfrotto quick release plate. Normally the device only comes with a screw which we can attach the camera to, and on the base of the unit are 2 1/4-20 threaded holes so you can align it to your tripod to try and get the camera on the right axis. So normally the camera would just sit on the platform and you'd be ready to go, but if you want to keep swapping the camera on and off, then it's ideal if you fit one of these Manfrotto quick release plates. And again, I'll put a link to these in the video description below. These are not the Manfrotto ones, these are actually clone ones. As I mentioned previously, you can slim this unit down if you want to get a little bit more stability. There's absolutely no need for macro photography to have the lateral adjustment slider on the unit. So to remove it, there is a screw in the base of the unit, and you just need to take a large screwdriver and undo the 1/4-20 screw, which is actually holding the horizontal component to the slide. And now you can use this 1/4-20 screw to affix to your camera. Once the top slide is off, you have the linear slide which you can use in the front to back direction. This is a 1/4-20 screw, so again you could mount your camera, or ideally mount the quick release plate on the top of the unit. So by using that 1/4-20 screw again, I can screw on the quick release plate onto the slide. The slide is then mounted onto the tripod and the camera can be fitted onto the quick release plate very quickly. Without that top extension, the horizontal slide, there's less chance of any movement from mirror flipping up if you're using a DSLR, or camera shake from the shutter actuation of the camera. I haven't actually noticed any using the top slide, but if you wanted to get this really precise, then this is the configuration you want to use. That's it for the video, hope you found that interesting. Don't forget, macro is a very specialist subject, so you may need to invest in some equipment to give you the best results. And with the focus stacking, remember you can use that in traditional landscape photography as well. You want the maximum depth of field in landscape photography. Your camera may only focus down from a meter to infinity, but then if you use the focus stacking facility, if you focus the camera down to 2 or 3 centimeters in the wide angle mode, take the first picture and then subsequently move the focus point using the lens focus towards infinity, you could stack those images in landscape photography to give you that maximum depth of field. Thanks very much for watching. If you're not a regular viewer to the channel, please consider clicking that subscribe button, and you will be notified then in your subscription list when I upload new videos to this channel. Don't forget, check out my photographic blog. I've got on there the monthly photographic challenge, where you're entitled to submit a picture for critique, and there'll be a public vote as to which is the best in the gallery. Also, hints and tips, especially for the Panasonic Lumix FZ200, if you're a FZ200 user. And there is my monthly newsletter, which I try to keep you updated of any changes to software revisions or programs that I've found that have been useful to me. So until my next video, Thanks again for watching, take care, and goodbye for now.